Hello, and welcome to the GameCraft Podcast. I'm your host, Mitch Lasky.
I'm Blake Robbins.
And this is a podcast about the business of video games. Episode 5, Going Global, the New Markets for Games. So one of the key changes in the video game business over the last 20 years is the influence of globalization. 20 years ago, the vast majority of video game revenues were generated from sales in just a few main geographies, the US, Japan, and Northern Europe. There were promising emerging markets in Korea, in Southern Europe, and in some of the wealthier locales like Singapore, the city-states of the Arabian Peninsula, and there were some initial stirrings in China. But by and large, at the apex of the packaged goods era, the games business was dominated by the big industrial democracies. That's no longer the case. In 2024, China now delivers roughly a quarter of total revenues in the games business, rivaling the once dominant North American market. The two most powerful Chinese publishers, Tencent and NetEase, have pursued aggressive global strategies and now own key gaming assets all over the world. With the majority of the world's gamers in Asia, the other territories in the region have also seen extraordinary growth. Korea has developed into a robust local games market, just under 10% of global market share, and the largest Korean publishers like Nexon now operate successfully outside Korea. The Southeast Asian game market, with its hub in Singapore, is serving a massive population in Vietnam, like 95 million people, Thailand, 72 million people, Indonesia, 270 million people, and the Philippines, 117 million people. And it's exploded in recent years, now amounting to roughly 7% of the global games market. Latin America and the Middle East and North Africa regions each have a market share of roughly 5% of the global game revenues and are among the fastest growing regions on Earth for games. And India, long dormant, but with a massive population of potential gamers, as many as 500 million viable game consumers by some estimates, is finally starting to emerge as a potential player on the global stage. So, regions that were effectively non-existent as game markets in 1995 now represent roughly half the global games business. And that is astonishing. And I fully expect that trend will continue. Unlike the demographics of the historically dominant geographies like Japan, North America, and Europe, which are experiencing stable population growth and rapidly aging populaces, these new territories, other than China, are populated by huge and growing numbers of young people, an ideal demographic mix for games consumption.
It's honestly mind-blowing. Like you said, 20 years ago, this was basically not a thing. There was a few major regions, but these emerging regions were not at all a thing. When you think about why that is, do you primarily attribute that to mobile, or what else is maybe attributing to all that?
I think there's a few things, but of course, mobile has been the primary driver. I mean, as we discussed in previous episodes, right, the proliferation of smartphones and through them, access to the internet is maybe the single biggest factor driving games worldwide. In almost every territory that we're going to discuss today, mobile gaming has kind of been the gateway drug.
It makes sense that mobile would be the key piece, but I have to imagine there's several other factors that contribute to this. Maybe broadband? Like, I'm trying to think of what is the other pieces that play into all this.
Well, let's parse them. So, like, let's talk about mobile first because it's so important. And we made this argument. It's really funny. Back in 2004, when we were on our roadshow for Jammed App, Michael Marchetti and I used to talk about the fact that this incredible mobile telecommunications revolution, where a lot of these regions that skipped the copper and coax infrastructure wire out that we saw in North America and in Europe and went straight to cellular. Their internet never had a terrestrial infrastructure. So they went right to cellular for the internet. And that telecommunications explosion, the ability to connect up these countries with communications technology, just created this hurricane force wind that drove not just cell phones into the markets, but all of the other apps that came with them. And gaming was a huge beneficiary of that. In fact, when we were on our roadshow, we used to say, don't buy our stock because we're a gaming company. Buy our stock because for every handset that gets sold, we're going to get X amount of rev share of dollars. And as a result, if you believe in the future of mobile internet, you have to own our stock because it's the only way you can play this incredible phenomenon of the massive tailwind of mobile driving mobile data and all of the appurtenant businesses into capitalism, basically.
It's crazy how far ahead of the time you were then. Like, obviously that was very prescient, but you were incredibly correct. But it's also the fact that you were spot on that mobile was going to catch on maybe even faster than PC and these other things. Makes sense now, but they really did. These regions basically have completely skipped the at-home desktop computer or PC gaming or just PCs at their home at all, or even laptops. And so that just speaks to what has happened in these regions. But specifically for games, that obviously means a whole bunch of implications, which we'll touch on later as well.
Yeah, it's really hard to understand just how much of an implication mobile had on some of these emerging markets if you haven't really spent time there. First of all, remember that with the local economies, the cell phone, particularly the less expensive Chinese-made Android phones that started flooding the market really in the sort of 2010s, they were orders of magnitude in terms of local buying power less expensive than buying PCs, laptops, tablets, sort of the other platforms you could use to play games. I'll tell you a quick story about India. I spent a long time in India when I was younger on two different occasions, combined to almost a year in the country. And then when I had my business, I started going back again and opened an office in Hyderabad. And the difference between when I was there in the 80s and 90s and when I was there in 2004 and later was just ridiculous. It's like we went back in 2004 to negotiate a distribution deal for Jamdat with Tata and Reliance, two local telecom operators. And, you know, it went from an environment where if you wanted to make a telephone call, it was an iffy kind of situation to get a local call done. And if you wanted to make an international call, you literally had to go to a post office, fill out a form in triplicate, and get in line to wait for a free trunk call to an overseas line. It was ridiculous. When we went back in 2004, every middle-class person I met had a cell phone. And a few years later, when we went back again, even the poorest people, the chaiwalas and the train stations or the street sweepers had phones. And this wasn't just an Indian phenomenon. Friends who spent time in Kenya or in China during the same period said that having a mobile phone was both a status symbol and essential to getting any kind of work in the local economy. And so games just got pulled into these markets behind that primary use case for mobile, which was telecommunications.
Yeah, like you said, games just naturally. Like if you were doing the Jamdat Roadshow and you're saying, hey, if you want exposure to this market, games are going to naturally just get a trickle effect of some percentage of growth as more people use phones. I do think it's really critical to just nail that, like, they skip a lot of the PC stuff that we've been talking about throughout this series, and they just fully lean into the mobile side, but they also get to take a lot of those lessons. And so I'm curious from as it started to evolve, if any major things started to emerge.
That's a crucial point, and I think you've nailed it. And that is, it wasn't just that they got the platform in a hardware form and the ability to run games, but it's because they skipped that terrestrial infrastructure and skipped the packaged goods era, by and large. They weren't beholden to any of those old models for distribution that held back the North American and European markets for such a long time, as they had to make that very painful transition from the old business models to the new. These new territories just started in the new business. And so those internet platforms and those new business models were the second really important piece of this. It was a way for people to access the internet. And in many cases, it was their primary way to access the internet. And so they brought all of those internet era distribution models with them to the party. And it changed the game.
It's fun to think about, like, them not having to deal with the packaged good era in some of these regions and instead just jumping to the modern era of games and being like, oh, what? Of course we're going to do free-to-play games. And this is all much more native. And as we get deeper into talking about some of these regions, it's very clear that they might actually be far ahead of where the U.S. is on some of this behavior.
Yeah, it was really interesting because it has been both obviously a driver of consumer growth, right, of customer-facing growth. But it's also been really important to the development of local developers and game publishers in the regions, because they also skipped the packaged goods industry. So they just showed up with free-to-play, in-app purchase, internet distribution, et cetera, as really the air that they breathed.
The countries that we've mentioned so far, they're not what you would conventionally think of as the economic powerhouses of China or the US, like, how should I think about the payment side of this? Or are there whales in these regions?
That's been an undiscussed part of this phenomenon, I think, that's worth really shining some light on. I think one of the main problems of bringing games and even more broadly e-commerce and other internet modes to these emerging markets is the fact that really only the wealthiest members of these societies have the kind of access to banking and to consumer credit that we really take for granted in the developed economies. And no banking or consumer credit means that there's no way to pay for digital goods. So I think that's been one of the biggest hurdles that we've had to overcome in the growth of some of these emerging markets. And I think it's still an ongoing problem. It's not really been solved. But there have been some clever ways that it's been addressed. I think early on in the mobile revolution, there were a bunch of these ad hoc type solutions, like, for example, the use of cell phone minutes as a currency. We saw that at its probably apex in Africa, where, you know, there were these technologies like M-Pesa in Kenya that arose that essentially replaced the currency of the country in terms of buying power and as a store of value. And in a lot of ways is very similar to the kind of fantasy arguments that a lot of crypto companies are making for the future of crypto, in the sense of being able to stand in for a very volatile, inflation-prone local economy with basically an alternative currency that everybody kind of gets around in electronic form. And that happened. That happened in Africa, and it happened in other countries as well.
Yeah, it also, when we start talking about platform-based publishers in some of these regions, especially when we look at China, which is not an emerging market, but let's talk about WeChat or WeGames, like, they mastered building the payments into it, again, because they started from a different place than maybe even the Western world. And I suspect that's happening in a lot of these emerging markets as well.
Yeah, I mean, I've spent time, again, in some countries where, for example, you can go to a corner shop where they sell basically magazines and cigarettes and pay cash to the vendor, and they have a little like square, like, you know, the square, the payment system, little device, and they can top up your SIM card and you can use that cash that's stored then in your SIM card to pay for things like games. So again, there's been real innovation and a lot of kind of ground level solutions to the problem. There's also kind of an interesting thing going on right now where the larger companies that have gotten with the program to wire up all of these local payment systems to each other so that they can offer them as a service to, for example, a Western publisher who wants to do business in a country where there is an iffy or where there's a highly fragmented local payment in infrastructure, can go to a company now like the Russian, I guess they've now moved to California, based company Exola. And they provide this like middleware layer, which interfaces all of these local payment systems to the publishers. And it's a really interesting concept. An old Activision colleague of mine, Chris Hewish, is running that business. And it's really helping game companies on the one hand access these markets. And on the other hand, it's interesting to see that company itself try to go beyond payments and use that beachhead to develop into a bit of a platform-based software-enabled company like we discussed in the last episodes.
Yeah, Exola is one of these companies that if you're not deep in the space, you certainly wouldn't know it existed. And then if you told anyone in our world of just venture capital about Exola, they would be like, isn't this just Stripe or I don't know, Adyen or one of these others? Exola obviously understood the pain point really clearly. And there is some really unique parts of the gaming ecosystem where they found a nice wedge. I do think it's an underappreciated part of, let's say, even Epic Game Store or Steam. Not that they're big in emerging markets, but they do handle the currency exchanges and accepting the payments. And it is just another bottleneck. When I've talked with people at Riot, for example, they talk about how they built out that payment system early on. And it's actually insane to think about the amount of work that they put into building out their payment system and doing it first party rather than using something like Exola or Stripe, which we now get to take for granted today.
Yeah, and look, if you're at the kind of scale that they were at, it makes sense because you are obviously paying, you know, a fee and something we'll talk about in future episodes. There is a cost to taking advantage of a third-party platform in order to do that work for you. And we see it most clearly, I think, most recently in the Apple pressure to go to a more open platform where they allow third-party game stores, for example, or app stores. You know, they're trying to pass along some of those costs or not, as the case may be, as fees, because there is a cost to it.
Yeah, that's exactly right. I think one other piece that might be contributing to all this and this growth is it may be more as an observer and as a gamer, is you're seeing these games reach other, like the Western market, for example, or you're seeing it break out in Asia. Do you have a hypothesis of why that's happening, or like why that's forming?
So I think part of it is during that initial period of growth, there was a really cool transition that happened where, rather than just being consumers of Western products, some of these regions started to develop their own local game development and cultures, and they started supplying products to their own markets. And because a lot of that was on mobile, obviously the costs of doing so were like orders of magnitude less than they would have been had they had to make a transition, let's say, into console or into PC and compete with Western products for AAA. That would have been prohibitive, right, given sort of the local economics. But given that mobile's development costs were so much lower, I think it allowed for what I'll call regionalization, which is this idea. I know that I'm using that word improperly and it means something else in a different context, but I'm going to steal it for this context, which is this idea of adapting game play patterns to local culture. And I think we're going to talk about further in this episode some examples of that, but I think that was an unappreciated driver of growth in some of these emerging markets. And I think on the other hand, obviously, Western and other, you know, Asian and European publishers got with the program and really invested in localization, the linguistic translation of products into local languages. And I think that was, I mean, obvious low-hanging fruit, but you'd be amazed from my era of the video game business back in the late 90s how infrequently publishers really took localization seriously.
Yeah, and I think we are entering a new era, or in the past, call it 5 years, we've entered a new era of this, which is the ones that are an emerging developer in these emerging markets, their games are actually doing well in the rest of the world. And a large part of that is, you know, they understand how to localize, but they're figuring out what is their specialty as a region. And maybe that's a good parlay into just talking about some of these regions in more depth.
Leah, let's pick up that and talk about the Middle East and North Africa as a region, because I think they have exemplified what you just talked about in terms of not only serving the local markets with regionalized products in the sense that I just described, but also doing what you just talked about, which is looking outward and using the Middle East and North Africa as a base to approach other markets all around the world with great success.
And when you say Middle East and North Africa, I'm assuming you're referring to like Turkey and Israel and Saudi Arabia. But like, are there any specific regions or countries that come to mind when you think of it?
So yeah, I think when we think of it, we're really thinking about the Gulf states. We're thinking about, you know, Israel and the Levant, and we're thinking about North Africa all the way to Morocco. And really the key markets in those regions in terms of population and game consumption are, as you said, Turkey, Saudi Arabia, Egypt, which is a huge country and a really good market for games, and also Israel, which is small in terms of its local consumption, but enormous in terms of its influence outside of Israel and with its export business. So yeah, you sort of wrap it all up. In terms of its local buying power, it's contributing maybe 5%, 4% of the global gaming revenues, growing at the fastest rate, by the way, of any region, around 5% annually during a period where, you know, as we discussed in a previous episode, most of the major markets are growing at 1%, or you look at the Chinese market growing sub 1%. But their influence on gaming outside of the region is probably amongst the largest, I would say, other than China.
Yeah, I mean, look, the export side of this business is what I'm excited to chat about, because it's just, it's crazy how well these regions have done of reaching global audiences. It's historically, again, 20 years ago, you say that a developer in Turkey is going to have one of the biggest games in the world. I think you and I both would have been like, wow, that's amazing, but also how? And so I think it's worth really drilling into that.
Yeah, let's talk about Turkey, because Turkey's been one of the real sort of shining stars of this phenomenon. They have produced, I think, multiple companies with greater than $1 billion market values.
Yeah, it's, I mean, Peak is the big one that sold to Zynga in, I think, 2020. But there's smaller ones like Gram Games even, which sold for several hundred million. And so there's certainly an emerging scene there. But you're starting to see, just like we know with startups, that once you have a couple of major success stories, the alumni of those startups get inspired and go and chase that dream as well. And no pun intended, but Dream Games is the new big one on the market with Royal Match, and they are absolutely crushing by all courts.
Yeah, Danny Reimer at Index, venture capitalist friend of ours, he told me it was the fastest growing revenue company in their portfolio. Dream Games, maybe a year ago. And Dream was started by ex-Peak employees. I visited Peak in Istanbul. I have a picture with Sidar Sahin, the CEO at the time, on the roof of their studio, which overlooked the Bosphorus. It's just super awesome to go and visit them and see their native game culture over there and hang out with them. And they hit it out of the park with a $1.8 billion outcome when they sold the company to Zynga, which is really remarkable.
Yeah, it's amazing. And maybe just drilling into that a little bit more, is they were sort of the pioneers or the leaders in a genre of mobile called Match 3 and these Match 3 puzzles. And naturally, things like Dream Games sort of took those lessons and they perfected it even more.
Yeah. And we'll talk a little bit later about, when we talk a little bit about the regionalization in the Middle East and North Africa, they also seized upon the idea of making those games specific to Egypt and to the Arabian Peninsula that had resonance in those markets, that used local play patterns from, you know, non-digital play patterns from board games, card games, et cetera, and had a lot of success with those as well.
So Turkey, for me, better or worse, I think of them as being the masters of puzzle and they've really perfected that. And I'm sure there's a bunch of reasons that I'm not well equipped to discuss of like why that is or why that region has outperformed on puzzle games. Maybe it's because their local regional games maybe are closer tied to that. But when you look at Israel, for example, like how should I think about them?
Oh, well, they are obviously the masters of the mobile casino and the hyper-casual gaming market. So, you know, you look at stuff like Playtika, which I think is currently public at about a $2.7 billion market cap and is, I think, sold to a Chinese consortium a few years ago. You know, Moon Active, I know a company you have been paying a lot of attention to, has gotten to significant scale. And really, they're getting to this scale almost entirely on an export basis, because the local Israeli market is tiny compared to the other parts of the region that we're discussing. I mean, compared to Egypt, compared to Saudi Arabia even, or Turkey, the Israeli population is just a fraction. But they punch above their weight, clearly, with regard to these export market opportunities for things like mobile and casino or hyper-casual.
Yeah, Israel in particular seems like they might have been the masters of the calculus of fun. Like they understood UA maybe at a level deeper than everyone else. And that is certainly the reputation within the industry, is that companies like Playtika, Moon Active, with CoinMaster, they just continue to be an absolute monster of a business that largely was built off of understanding this calculus of fun and how to do user acquisition better than most of the market.
Yeah, maybe we could turn and look at one of the most interesting recent developments in this region, and that is the emergence of Savvy, which is the Saudi Arabian Sovereign Wealth Fund's game investment arm. And they spun out with a $38 billion war chest that they've used to go out and invest in public companies like Nintendo, Electronic Arts, Nexon, Take-Two, as well as acquiring mobile publisher Scopely on the private market recently for roughly $5 billion. It's being run by former Activision executive Brian Ward. He and I didn't overlap when we were there. He came a couple of years after I was gone, but clearly has been steeped in that Activision culture. And they've got a mandate to go out and build Saudi's presence in gaming, both sort of on an investment basis, but also on a local development basis.
It definitely feels close to running the Tencent model of a decade ago of making these really strategic investments. I'm going to be really curious to see how it plays out, because in theory, this is the time for them to strike, especially as China maybe gets more restricted on their outside acquisitions. So,
yeah.
And obviously, we saw it with Savvy acquiring Scopely at a very opportune time, and Monopoly Go is you know, still sitting at the top of the grossing charts right now.
Yeah, it was a good acquisition. I think they paid a decent price for it. It wasn't too crazy. So I feel like they're exercising some discipline. But obviously, I think your point is well taken. Now, where money is much tighter in the investment areas of both Europe and the United States and China, they're sitting on a big pile of cash. And I think that it's going to be interesting to see how they use it. So far, I would say I'm very impressed by just the moves that they have made and the clear thinking that seems to be present, you know, behind driving that strategy. I think another thing that's kind of interesting we didn't talk about is, you know, what games work in the region. I mean, I talked briefly about it in the context of Peak's development of these local play patterns, but it's cool if you look at the charts. The global games like the Ludo variants, like FIFA, like PUBG, mobile, they're very successful in the region. But there are also these things like Tarnib and Hakam, these local card games that are similar to, let's say, Bridge or Hearts or Spades, a card game called Balut that I don't know much about at all. There was a strategy game on the charts in the region based on the Arabian mythos called Revenge of the Sultans that was, you know, up in top five status on some of these charts. So it's really an interesting mix of sort of both Western and local products. And I think that's really cool. And it suggests, you know, that they're really not just a consumer of the Western stuff, but they are going to be a developer in their own right and a supplier, a product to their own market over time, which I think is very useful and suggests that there's going to be some long-term health in the market.
Yeah, I was going to say that rather than just being a pure export region and then importing sort of the global games industry, I think the fact that you can have games thrive within your own local market is for sure the best sign of health. And you know, China is probably the most perfect example of that, where, I mean, so many of those games are specific to that region, and you almost never see them break out into the rest of the world. And if you can reach that scale in Saudi Arabia or any of these markets where these are very big markets, there's a huge opportunity to grab, and having your local developers actually built for them is an amazing signal.
So let's turn to Latin America, because that's the other sort of 5% market in terms of global revenue. So roughly equivalent to the Middle East and North Africa. And it's the second fastest growing region with revenue growth rates around 4%. So just a little bit less than the Middle East and North Africa. It's a big market in terms of players and really dominated by two countries in particular, Brazil, the most populous country in that region, and to a lesser extent, Mexico, among the wealthier countries in that region. In terms of content, it's probably 75% mobile in terms of gamers and 50% mobile in terms of revenue. And unlike the Middle East and North Africa and China, as you discussed, its tastes tend to run similar to US and European markets without much local, culturally specific games on the market. It's been pretty stagnant until recently. I mean, Brazil banned a lot of video games in the 1990s, and after they lifted those bans, they taxed video games really aggressively up until quite recently. But once those taxes were eased, I think the local market was really juiced. And you can see it in the growth rates, and you can see it in the fact that they've really come onto the global stage as a really significant market.
Yeah, I mean, you and I have talked about esports quite a bit on this podcast, but Brazil is one of those regions that continues to be like the most emerging of esports. I mean, Counter-Strike and League of Legends are absolutely massive there, and these players are huge, huge stars. I think even bigger than they are in the Western world, and might even rival some of the biggest stars in China.
Yeah, that's kind of a cool thing about that market, which is that it does have an online influencer culture that is really significant and unique amongst some of these local markets.
Yeah, I mean, the YouTubers and streamers in Brazil I mean, you can go look at the top Twitch streamers. It will probably be some Brazilian streamer, which is amazing. Like, it's incredible how much they've embraced that market. And naturally, that has a bunch of ripple effects into the gaming market of what games emerge there. But like you said, it is largely these Western games that are doing well over there. But there is, Brazil is also, you know, obviously we're familiar with it with Wildlife and the newest partner, Victor, at Benchmark. But Brazil is a region that exports games successfully as well.
Oh, yeah.
I don't know if you want to add anything there.
Yeah, I mean, I think it sort of started back, you know, decades ago with port houses, right? There were some really important port houses in the region, in Argentina, in Chile, in Brazil. And some of those companies like Nimble Giant, like others have transitioned. Nimble Giant was acquired by Embracer in Argentina.
When you say port houses, what do you mean by that?
Oh, I mean companies that we would use in the West, for example, at Activision or Electronic Arts, to do platform-specific versions of games that were written on other platforms. Hmm. That's really where a lot of these local developers cut their teeth doing that kind of work, doing outsource work. But many of them have developed into publishers of their own right. And yeah, you referenced Wildlife. I think, you know, again, and Wildlife is an interesting one because it shows an important factor in this region, which is the inaccessibility of outside investment. A lot of these regions have really catapulted into the mainstream based a lot on outside investment, on venture capital or private equity money that's come in, or even strategic money that's come from outside of the regions. And I think Latin America has historically been quite starved of this kind of outside investment. Wildlife is really the company in the region that bucked the trend. In fact, according to a survey I read, they were the only company in Latin America that successfully raised two rounds of funding from foreign investors, which is amazing. And yeah, just full disclosure, it's a Benchmark investment, and although not one of mine, and Victor, the former CEO, recently joined Benchmark as a partner.
You mentioned an interesting point, because even one of the crazier things is, even let's talk about Peak Games, which you went and met, like you met them. They had raised outside capital, not a lot, but they did attract capital from outside of the region. And it isn't something I fully appreciated up until this moment, where you're talking about Wildlife. I mean, you can hear early stories from Victor of, you know, they tried to raise money. No one would give them any money. And ultimately, that probably ended up being a good thing in the short term for them, because they built an incredible business off of the back of being bootstrapped and sort of being forced to be resourceful. But it's something I just hadn't fully appreciated until this moment.
Yeah, I think it's very significant. And look, it's a lot of the problems of the region, really in terms of its development as a leading games market, are economic, right? And that's obviously something we're going to be seeing in many of these emerging markets, is that just the absence of local buying power and the instability of the local economies does really kind of put a lid on the opportunities in the region. And I think it's very important to keep that in mind when we talk about some of these places. In fact, it leads to some real local oddities that we've discussed in previous season. For example, in our last episode of season one, we talked about the RuneScape gold farming boom in Venezuela, where essentially gold farming in RuneScape became a way to route around the collapse of the local currency and the inability to find local employment. So, you know, when gaming is filling that need, I think you're sort of way beyond the leisure component of the market. And although on the other hand, I think it does suggest that in some of these regions, the growing idea of play to earn, which we did again talk about last season, is very important, because it does provide a potential lifeline on the one hand and sort of a productive activity on the other.
Yeah, it's a really important call out, and it's something that we're going to continue to see. I'm excited to see how it plays out, and like you said, it might be that crypto really does find product market fit in Latin America. We've obviously seen it quite a bit in the Philippines and these other regions, which maybe is a good parlay of talking about Southeast Asia.
Yeah, that's a good, yeah. Southeast Asia is one of my favorite regions to discuss, because it's so interesting. It's one of the most dynamic and important of the emerging markets It's a region that encompasses, as I discussed in the intro, these massively populous countries like Thailand, Vietnam, Indonesia, the Philippines. The demographics of Southeast Asia are extremely young, so it's very fertile for the growth of a gaming audience. And it's got a real benefit in this global trade and banking hub in Singapore, which really functions really as a locus for investment in the region, and where a lot of companies feel like they can get access to banking and trade in a stable manner to base their headquarters and really move into the region from Singapore. So that's turned out to be a very important component of the market. And it now represents, I think, you know, roughly 7% of the global game revenues. A very successful and vibrant market.
And when you say Southeast Asia, I immediately just think of sea. Is that fair to say? Like, yeah. I for better or worse, that's the company I associate with Southeast Asia.
That seems to be the big dog in the region. Sea Limited, which started life as Garena, and actually, interestingly, back in 2011, and when they had just come online, and literally online, because that was their original business, they were a online publisher for games into the local markets. They did a deal with us at Riot, and we brought League of Legends to Southeast Asia through Garena, and they used it as a real engine of growth and went on to license EA's FIFA, Activision's Call of Duty, and were really the tip of the spear for bringing those products into the region. In 2017, they rebranded as Sea Limited. They kept the Garena name for their gaming division, and then they diversified into e-commerce, I think, really successfully. Tencent, in their inimitable fashion of really getting ahead of the market, bought 20% of the company in 2017, and it subsequently went public on NASDAQ, and today trades at like a $24 billion market cap.
Yeah, it's a part of me wonders, because they were just crushing it so well on the digital goods or e-commerce side of their games, that they were like, we could also run an e-commerce business in general. But they see as an example of a company that really learned from the success of, let's say, Tencent and Wii Games or Steam or any of these other platforms. And they understood that they had to build the major platform for games. And obviously that Riot partnership early on really, really helps them out. But it's pretty, pretty incredible that the business that they've built off of the back of that. And if you are trying to publish in Southeast Asia, you are likely trying to talk with Sea.
Yeah. I mean, think about it. 500 million or more, I think. I've seen some reports upwards of 700 million monthly active users on the platform. And 100 million paying users on the platform. And just even in the games business alone, leaving aside the e-commerce business, which is huge, they're doing $3 billion a year in game revenues, which would make them, you know, close to a major by my standards that we discussed in our overview episode earlier this season. I mean, that is really significant for a region with the challenges that the Southeast Asian region presents.
Yeah, I mean, it would be notable even in the West, but for it to happen in a region that is historically associated with a lower paying customer, lower willingness to pay customer, that is just quite remarkable, the penetration that they've gotten in the region. It's also notable that C, while they published these third-party games, they really proved themselves when they developed their first-party mobile shooter, which was Free Fire, that is just absolutely crushed. I mean, it is one of the biggest mobile games in the entire world. And to see that come out of Sea is just a real testament to their ability to build, but also understanding the market. So not only are they importing and doing these partnership deals, they are also exporting. And we'll talk about Free Fire a bunch over just even later on in the India episode. But Free Fire captured the entire global gaming market, especially in a market that you wouldn't have ever thought a mobile shooter could do as well as as it has.
Yeah, and before moving on, let's talk a little bit about Singapore. I mentioned earlier just how important Singapore has been as this sort of trade hub and banking hub for outside investment and for the headquartering of these regional publishing businesses. I think it's going to get even more important as we move forward, because I think as the economic troubles in China continue, we're going to see a lot of entrepreneurs and money trying to get out of the country and heading toward the freer markets, shall we say, of Singapore in the midst of the regulatory clampdowns we're going to discuss later in this episode in China. And in addition, there's been some really good game-specific venture firms like Play Ventures and Makers that have set up a Singaporean presence. And I think that's really important because that's going to help grow that local, regionalized game development industry in that is so important to the lasting success of these regions.
Yeah, it's sort of the open secret of the entire industry is that if you are a successful game developer in China or an entrepreneur in China, you're likely trying to move your business or start your next business in Singapore. And it's just the open secret right now. One of the biggest success stories recently is a mobile studio called Habby, which they've just absolutely crushed with their games Survivor.io and Arch Hero and a few others. I mean, they are truly one of the biggest success stories in all of mobile. There used to be a Chinese, it's a Chinese team that moved and set up in Singapore, and they've absolutely crushed.
Hmm. Super interesting. I'm long Southeast Asia. So let's turn and talk quickly about Sub-Saharan Africa, because unfortunately, there's not a whole lot going on in Sub-Saharan Africa. It's the smallest of the emerging game markets. And, you know, the classic problems that have held back economic development in Africa broadly are present in the games business as well. Lack of local spending power, limited penetration of smartphones, the absence of viable payment systems, like all of these things are really exacerbated in the sub-Saharan African market. Probably in its entirety, the market's under $1 billion in total revenues, and the majority of that is coming from a couple of wealthy countries like South Africa and to a lesser extent, Nigeria, Ghana, and Kenya. The sales charts in the region look surprisingly similar to those in the United States and other major industrialized countries in terms of titles, with games like Candy Crush, Monopoly Go, Call of Duty, and Fortnite very popular throughout the region.
Yeah, one of the notable ones that we should probably just call out is there's a company called Carry First that is, in a lot of ways, I think models after the success of Sea or Tencent, where they are trying to take a very endemic approach to this region. And my understanding is that they are trying to solve for the viable payment systems, the platform side of all this. And they've raised quite a bit of money from foreign firms. Like, you know, you have Bitcraft and a few others. I think even Andreessen is an investor over there. And so it is one to keep an eye on. And I suspect that if anyone were to nail it, it's a well-funded platform from the West.
Yeah, I mean, there are some promising factors like that present. I mean, they've raised tens of millions of dollars, Carry First, and I think that is the right strategy as an early entry into a region that's still developing. So we'll see how that works out over the years. But it feels like it's going to take some real clever entrepreneurship on the business model side to make Africa happen. And again, there's some good underlying demographics, but there's also some crushing issues economically in terms of seeing it happen. So finally, before we talk about China to close out, let's spend a few minutes talking about India. For the last 20 years, India has been the sleeping giant of potential game markets, a highly computer literate middle class armed with increasing disposable income, high penetration of smartphones. It just seemed inevitable that India would experience a China-like explosion of gaming at some point. I mean, we talked about it in the intro, 500 million potential gamers in that market. And, you know, English as at least a second language is very prevalent. So it makes it a very easy market for a lot of Western companies to operate in. And look, many large Western companies, myself included, outsource development to some of the massive tech centers in Hyderabad and Bangalore. And that's been going on for decades. I had a team of several dozen engineers doing game ports for my mobile games in Hyderabad back in the 2000s. So there's long been a sizable pool of at least engineering talent in the country, although significantly not as much on the art and design side. So all of that, you know, to play into the idea of jumpstarting a local development industry, it feels like India was really poised to do so.
Yeah, it's for all the reasons you just outlined, you would expect that it would have already been a booming industry. So I'm curious, what do you think has held it back so far?
I think it's two things. One is economic and one is political. And there's a degree of also cultural pressure as well we could talk about. And then again, this is a country I've spent a lot of time in my youth and again, in my adulthood as a business person. And so I have a huge affinity for the country and its people. And I really want to see it happen. So it has been something of a disappointment to me that it has taken this long to happen, although I'm starting to see some cracks in the ice, which could drive it forward. So let's talk about those challenges. You know, we talked about the number of potential gamers. The market, despite that, is still very small, maybe 2 to 3 billion in annual revenues, maybe 1 to 2% of the global gaming market, which, again, is not very significant. I think we'll talk a little bit later about sort of the political side of this. In terms of the cultural side of it, I have a theory. It's kind of a strange theory, which is that in order for a territory to really mature as a game market, you need to have seen three generations of prosperity. And let me explain this, because it's absurd, but it's my pet theory, and that is that the first generation is the generation of really mainstream entrepreneurship, and then the second generation sees that and starts to diversify, and the third generation are the children of that second generation who kind of reject the mainstream values and want to do something more punk rock, like build video games for a living. And I think in India, there's a lot of societal and familial pressure that makes, you know, doing something in the arts or doing something, you know, that's outside of engineering or the civil service, which have been those pathways to prosperity that people have seen in previous generations. It makes them sort of a little debased. And I think we saw this in China as well. And they emerged from it extremely well in the 2010s. But I think it's still present in the Indian market to some degree.
Yeah, I mean, like that conceptually makes sense. I like the theory. I mean, it certainly checks out in the major regions that you and I know well.
Yeah, I mean, I think a real sociologist would have a few things to say about it. But just anecdotally, it does feel like there's something to it. But let's talk about optimism, because that's what we're all about here. And I think some developments in the last few years have made me a lot more optimistic about what's going on in the Indian games market. So in 2016, India had really the mobile boom that we started to see glimmers of back in even as far back as 2004, 2005, when Reliance Jio, which was one of their major mobile operators, basically started a price war with its competitors, really drove the cost of mobile phone tariff down, you know, countrywide, and expanded the market for mobile hugely, particularly as their competitors had to follow suit on the pricing side. And so I think that was a major driver. And in the wake of that expansion, you started to see mobile domestic game companies come to the market, like Encore in Bangalore, for example. And then the market even opened further, allowing a lot of foreign games companies to distribute into the country. And I mean, this has also been one of those things that's held India, you could say, back in some ways, and that's helped them in other ways. And that is that they have always been a very difficult market for foreign companies to operate in. I remember when I first started going there in the 80s, like, you couldn't get Western soft drinks, for example, because they were banned or they were tariffed out of the market with import restrictions. And as a result, there were local analogs of the Western soft drinks, which sort of replaced them in the market. But I think that in recent years, India's opened up much more to import. And as a result, you started to see things like PUBG Mobile, which shipped into India as Battlegrounds Mobile India from Krafton, that started to see some success on mobile platforms. C, whom we discussed in the previous section, brought Free Fire into the market and started to see some real success. And obviously, you know, the mobile casual business started to expand as well.
Yeah, and it's one of those things where Free Fire and Battlegrounds Mobile were massive, massive hits here, like truly massive hits. Obviously, the 500 million plus gamers that you alluded to, they started to really come online.
Yeah, but politics unfortunately entered into the equation. And in 2020, there was a flare-up of the 40-year-old border conflict between India and China over some disputed Himalayan valleys. And it, you know, a low-scale shooting war started up there. And as a result, India, in retaliation, banned 118 Chinese apps from the Indian market. And that included battlegrounds that included Free Fire. And I think Free Fire basically got hit by collateral damage there because of the Tencent investment. They were viewed as a Chinese company despite their Southeast Asian presence. And as a result, you know, those companies could not do business in the country. I think the ostensible reason being that there was a threat of espionage from the fact that Indian citizens had to game on Chinese servers in order to play those games, or at least servers outside of the country.
Yeah.
I've actually visited that Himalayan region where this took place. I got one of the few visas back in the 90s to go to the Spiti Valley and traveled all the way up to the Tibetan border, which is where which is highly militarized in this region. And it was really freaky because you're up there at sort of, you know, the valleys are 11, 12,000 feet above sea level. And, you know, the only people out there basically are yak shepherds and soldiers.
Wow. I have so many questions, but I'll leave the listeners on a cliffhanger of why you were out there.
Why are you out there being the most important? But
I mean, look, I'm sure there's some great reason, but we'll leave the listeners on a cliffhanger there.
I can assure you, I do not work for the Central Intelligence Agency.
Yeah. So, you might be the threat of espionage there.
but the ban was really brutal, right? It just kicked a lot of the momentum out of the market.
Yeah, I mean, they even banned TikTok during that time, and sort of the unspoken hero of all that was Facebook or Meta, where Instagram Reels sort of just completely replaced TikTok in that region. So it wasn't just games that got hit, but it was a real blow to the game developers that were importing into this region.
Yeah, and as we'll see when we look at China, when something like that happens, and you see the potential for that government retaliation or that government intrusion broadly into a market like games, it causes outside investors to really take a pause and say, hey, is this really a region that we want to invest in? And I think that happened in the Indian market as well. So look, by 2023, Free Fire was back in the market. They satisfied the Indian government by moving the servers into in-country and rebranding as Free Fire India. And so they're back on the market as of 2023, and other companies that were subject to the bans are slowly making their way back into the market. But I think the damage was done to a large degree, and it really did hamper foreign investment. That said, we are now seeing some interesting local gaming studios come up in the country, and I'm kind of excited about that as a really important development. So you have Ogrehead in Hyderabad. They have this game Asura and others that are based on local cultural touchstones and mythologies. One new one I'm particularly interested in is from this company called Super Gaming, which is developing a product called Indus Battle Royale. And it's got this really cool Indo-futurist theme for its Battle Royale game and looks gorgeous. Like, it's just a really cool looking game.
Yeah, they've really leaned into the cultural side of this. Like, it's clearly a studio building for their audience, their core audience, and their local market, which I just really appreciate.
I actually think this one will work on a global basis with the right marketing, because I do think it's weird and cool in a way that I think might make it accessible even beyond the Indian market. So I think foreign investment is really starting to trickle back in. You know, a Western company funded Super Gaming. Our friend Bing Gordon, along with Sequoia, backed this company called Mayhem Studios to develop Underworld Gang Wars, which is another battle royale game. So while the jury's still out on whether India can deliver on this latent promise of a massive games market, I think it's fair to assume that it could get to parity with at least the Middle East or Latin America in terms of revenue within the next few years.
Yeah, it's one where, like you said, the potential is there. I mean, the market is just so massive that part of you is just like, man, this could be the next China if they do it right. But obviously, a lot has to fall in place. Even they have to have their sights on the Middle East and Latin America before they can even dream of going out to the Chinese market.
So let's finish this exploration of these emerging markets with a quick look at China. I mean, on the one hand, it seems kind of ridiculous to talk about China in the context of emerging markets because the Chinese game industry is now so well established as one of the largest and most important in the world. Chinese gamers contribute almost $45 billion to the global game revenues, a 10x increase over the last 15 years. Chinese publishers are operating successfully all over the world. They've made some remarkably forward-thinking strategic acquisitions. For example, Tencent buying Riot, Supercell, almost half of Epic, as well as numerous smaller developers. Chinese developers themselves are now successfully exporting products to Western markets in a way that would have been unthinkable in earlier years, where their market was their local market, their local developers were purely serving domestic consumption. So instead of talking about it, and I mean, that's all we really need to say about it from that perspective, China's a monster. But let's talk a little bit about the challenges that the Chinese market is currently experiencing as a result of the slow growth of the overall Chinese economy and also the impact of some government regulation, because that regulation plays a more significant role in China than perhaps in any other territory on earth.
Yeah, China, for all of the credit that they get for having this boom of revenue, there are some real pieces that hold them back. And one could argue that the next 10 years might not look the same as the past 10 years.
Yeah, in many ways, I think you could argue, although I might not make this argument, I think it's a fair argument, that in terms of revenue, users, foreign access, and local publisher power, it may have peaked in 2020.
When you say that, you're saying primarily from an importing perspective.
No, right? I think, I mean, just taking all those factors together, right? It's like, so revenues are way down. They're after years and years of hyper growth, as we discussed, right? A 10x over 15 years is insane. This year, they're projected to grow under 1%, which is among the slowest growing markets in the world during this period. I mean, we're concerned about slow growth in the West, but I think, you know, at 0.7% growth, which is what is predicted, I think, for the Chinese market this year, that's very significant. Foreign access, obviously, we'll talk about in terms of the way that the Chinese Communist Party has imposed restrictions on licensing. In terms of restriction on play and payments, I think that puts a lot of pressure on user growth in the country and, of course, subsequently on revenue growth. And I think, you know, in terms of local publishing power, the changes that the government has imposed on the local market has affected those companies in very profound ways. And as a result, I think it's weakened them in terms of their ability to compete on the global stage.
Yeah. I mean, look, you summarized that incredibly well. You mentioned that it peaks in 2020. Is there a reason why you think 2020 was the year? I mean, obviously COVID and all this stuff happens, but is that fair to say that's why you think it peaked?
So I think, yeah, particularly given what was happening outside of China. I mean, I think in 2020, 2021, the Western markets, you know, you see a camel hump, if you will, on in terms of those markets when you were because there were unnatural growth rates created by the COVID lockdowns and also by the economic stimulus in many of the Western countries where the governments were essentially paying people to stay at home and people were using that economic stimulus in some cases to game. The Chinese market didn't experience that, and a couple of things contributed to that. One of the most important was that in 2021, the ruling Chinese Communist Party sort of flexed their authoritarian muscles and imposed really strict limits on game play time, ostensibly to protect minors in the country. And given the ubiquity of their surveillance state, it really had a chilling effect on the local games market. Although, interestingly, I read a subsequent sociological study that was conducted on just what that impact was, and it seems like the laws were widely ignored by core gamers, and it had much more of an effect, at least anecdotally, on the casual gaming market and certainly on the market for the youngest gamers. So a lot of people suspect that the real reason for the ban wasn't so much to protect the moral virtue of Chinese children or whatever, but it was to really lessen the impact of foreign culture and ideology from entering the Chinese market through games, something that the Great Firewall of China, for example, has been actively imposing on the local populace for years.
Yeah, and I think around that time, it was probably when they issued their suspension on outside publishers as well. Is that right?
Outside publishers and domestic publishers, yeah, right around that same time, they announced an 8-month suspension of grants for new gaming licenses. And that's really, really significant. I mean, you know, we've talked about it in the last episode when we were talking about indies, where you mentioned just the number of games that are released on Steam in any one year. And you look at it, it's now well over 10,000 that are coming to market on Steam in any particular year. You look at the same market in China, and it's in the hundreds. So a market that was already only allowing a trickle of new games to come onto the market suddenly has ceased allowing any new games to come onto the market for like an 8-month period. And in my opinion, that had a much greater chilling effect on the Chinese games industry than the play ban did.
Yeah, look, I mean, the Chinese market has this very strange policy of restricting the number of new games that come out every single year. What that means is if you are Tencent, you only have a certain number of medallions that you're going to greenlight. And ultimately, that means that you're going to favor your own first-party games and even a third-party game or anything like that. But 8 months of not greenlighting any new games from a government level has some really chilling effects.
Absolutely. And it affected the Western publishers as well, because as we've discussed in previous episodes, the Western publishers had been telling Wall Street for years that the Chinese market was their great opportunity, their great new growth opportunity, this new market where there were, you know, a billion people and they were going to be able to distribute their games there. And China was opening to Western capitalism. And here's this huge revenue opportunity that's going to continue to fuel growth of these game publishers for decades. And suddenly that looked very uncertain indeed. And as you and I both know, public markets really don't like uncertainty.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, there's another piece within this though, which is some of these developers in China were like, we have a game, we still need to release it. And so they actually just went and released them in Western markets, which had another weird trickle-down effect in the entire ecosystem.
Yeah, I think you're right. And I think the other real consequence of that, I will call it the squeezed balloon there, where, you know, that air had to go somewhere. I think it was also a driving factor behind a lot of these relocations we've seen to Singapore.
Yeah, exactly. And it's the uncertainty and fear of the government overreaching is very real and maybe at an all-time high in the region.
So the government strikes again this past December. And this is, I think, really worth talking about because this was profound. So they came back into the regulatory environment with these spending limits on games, making certain monetization tactics illegal. And again, ostensibly in the name of consumer protection, imposing even more draconian restrictions on gaming in China. And once again, the uncertainty that was produced by that move roiled the public markets almost immediately. I mean, overnight, that got priced into the major game stocks in China. $80 billion in enterprise value was wiped out of the market overnight. Think about that. $80 billion in market value. That's the accumulated value of the five companies that we discussed in the platform episode earlier this season was gone literally in 24 hours. NetEase lost 25% of its market cap. Tencent lost 16%, $54 billion in enterprise value overnight. It was the biggest of several blows that these companies have endured over the last decade, because every time one of these regulations comes into the market, those companies take the hit. And it was so big that the Chinese Communist Party almost immediately rescinded the restriction and, you know, tried to roll it back. But the damage was clearly done because, you know, once something like that happens, everybody looks at that market and says that could happen again.
Yeah. I mean, for context, that would be like Activision Blizzard just going out of business overnight in the Western market. It's one of these things where, obviously, in the Western world, we talk about investing in China and these things, but there is a reason to be a little bit nervous to be investing into these markets. And so I understand why those get pulled back in the way that they do, because if you are holding that as an outsider, you no longer have real control or understanding of what is going to happen in these markets, especially when the government is going to step in like this.
Yeah, and the Communist Party did offer a tiny olive branch along with that big stick that they brought to the party. They approved 105 new games, including, interestingly, 40 foreign games for publication in the country earlier this year. But along with the broader retreat in the Chinese economy that's been caused by a variety of factors, including softness in their really speculative real estate market, which trickles down to consumer spending in a really meaningful way, the China gaming miracle seems very uncertain at the present. And I think it's fair to say, again, that you know, those who are calling the peak in 2020, I don't think they're completely insane. I do think, however, that it shows an important problem in that market long term, which is, and authoritarian markets in general around the world, which is that desire to have centralized control and to exert, for whatever reason, whether moral or economic, some kind of influence over the market, has to be weighed by those local authorities against the damage that they're doing to their own economies when they do so. And obviously, we saw in this case the almost immediate rescinding of those spending limits was a recognition, and I think that they went too far, and that they can't act with full impunity against their local companies without damaging the very basis for their rule.
And like we've talked about before, it sort of forces these developers, and there is incredible talent in these regions, to start thinking about, how do I build an enduring business?
So I think in this episode, we've tried to provide at least some semblance of an overview of what's going on in the broader market beyond our sometimes myopic view of the Western markets or Japan in terms of their driving of the video game business. I think in the era that we now inhabit, there is incredibly dynamic and interesting activity happening everywhere. And how we harness that, how we see some of those markets develop, and in particular, where it makes sense to invest and where it doesn't, are some really interesting questions that we have to ask ourselves as an industry as we move forward.
Yeah, I mean, look, and I will disclaim, or put a disclaimer on this episode, that this stuff moves so fast that this might be the least evergreen episode that we discuss, and that you know, who knows what one of these regions will do tomorrow. But this is something that everyone should be paying attention to, and like you said, this is one for, if you're building for these audiences, deeply understanding the nuances of these markets is so key, but also just from an investment perspective, it's very critical to understand.
Well, thank you. And I think I'm very excited to move on to our next episode, where we're going to discuss customer acquisition and distribution. And hopefully that will be one of our most evergreen episodes that we ever record. I think it's going to be one of the more interesting looks at a problem. We're going to take a slightly different view than I think most people would expect us to take as we discuss it. So I'm very excited to have that conversation with you.
I'm excited.
Thanks.